a man that came in the shadow of Muhammad Ali. And that's about all you could do after Ali is be a shadow. You know? Ali just was so great at what he did. But this young man, Holmes, was making his mark in history. In fact, he had already made it. You check his record with Marciano, and the kind of bums that Marciano fought, and the average age of the bums that he fought, you would know that Marciano was a bum too. I'm not racist. I just feel he was a bum. He's a fighter, you know. So he just did it for beating up Lewis. But Lewis was on his way down in the valley and just had about reached it. Does he get credit for beating up Archie Moore, who was already an old man? Or as a child? Wait. Larry Holmes had already done. But naturally, he wanted to record, and that's the way it should be. He wanted to go out in a blaze of glory as the only black man, the only heavyweight champion that we've ever had, to go out victorious, never having been defeated, with sense, with money, with security for his family, and with a good reputation. He risked it all on Mrs. Bates. I know that Larry Holmes was the better man, but the better man could not beat the other man because the better man had underestimated. And in his arrogance, he didn't give God a chance to get him right to the door and give him the victory. He tried to get out of this myself, God. You know, the only thing you hear. Need to go some of them other heavy things, but this is a nice way to say that I can't get this. That's what you make Rose do. You forget too quickly. The wine of praise, the wine of adulation, the wine of admiration. The drunk is the And then Allah takes a little man and gives a lesson to the book. And the little man was caught with the belt, though the little man could not stand up to many in the heavyweight division whom Holmes had crucified. But God gives us a lesson in him. Holmes got right to the door and blew it off. Moses got right to the door of the promised land and spoke independent of God and blew it off. And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, Moses made that mistake that he might walk perfect. How can you walk perfect? No, that you're nothing. Not nothing in the sense that the white man makes you nothing. I don't mean that. But you've been thinking you're nothing all your life. That's not the nothing I'm talking about. The kind of nothing that the white man makes you think of is the nothing that can never be done. But the nothing I'm talking about is zero that only needs one to stand beside it so zero can become two. when one gets behind, see, it generates the power of itself into them, and nothing becomes here. So the chapter that I'm reading from is the 110th chapter. You see, it has two ones backing up nothing. And I just want to say to you that before the Honorable Elijah Muhammad left us, he said these words to me. He said, "Brother, the same power that is with me will be with you." He said, "In fact, about it, there'll be two of us backing you up." Now, when you hear me out there roaring, it ain't nothing. It's nothing resting on two feet. I know the broadcast is coming to a close. I'm sorry that time just runs by so fast. But when I was going to California, they had created a furor in California. I was in the desert fixing up my stuff. And I would call California, "How things going?" When I began to hear what was happening in California, immediately I saw the scriptures. I saw myself racing toward a destiny that is very soon, very soon. I saw the jealousy and the envy of my own brothers and sisters who don't want to recognize where this success is coming from. That it's coming from Almighty God. And the worst enemy we got among us is envy and jealousy. I saw the chief priests. I saw the leaders. I saw the Jews and the Gentiles. The Jews working behind the scenes to get blacks and Gentiles to denounce me as though that was going to stop me from doing what I was coming there to do. The government calls me a bigot and a messenger of hate, cloaking myself in religion. He is a Caucasian demon whose people have caught themselves in religion and robbed Africa, Asia, Central and South America in the name of Jesus. He is a no good bastard. Now, wait a minute. I'm not cussing. I said a no good bastard. I'm not cussing. He's the only illegitimate child of God. He's a grafted devil. He is a bastard. Don't even belong to my father. Gonna tell me that I'm not welcome in California. As though he's the owner of California, when the scripture said the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. How can any white man who is an illegitimate man on this earth tell me where I cannot legitimately set my foot when he's not a native of no part of the earth? You are arrogant devil. a pitiful meeting. They had gotten together and agreed,
we are not going to repudiate Farrakhan until after he speaks.
In other words, we'll hold ourselves out and say, Farrakhan, if you don't tone your message down, mister, then the governor will repudiate you in front of us, and we'll repudiate you behind your back. I told him, your master don't handle power. And you know, if I'm not afraid of his repudiation, yours don't mean nothing. Can you imagine a bunch of Negro leaders repudiating me? Who the hell are you leading anyway?
You don't have no... You don't have the people.
You just little frogs. Your master get inside you, and then here you go.
Get it. Get it. Get it.
Yes, I am mocking you because you're not leaders. You're punks that are controlled by those who don't have no power over nothing anymore. They just call you and you obey them.
If you want to get the copy of this tape, I'm not going to stop. I got a few more minutes.
You call this number right now, 994-5775. White or black, call. We're not afraid for you to have the tape. You say tomorrow is the time I call Duke Mason an illegitimate child.
Or say it the way I said it, a bastard.
You take me to court and I'll prove he's a bastard. I'm anxious for you. My father raised me up just for this purpose, to fight for the liberation of black people. Not just here, but wherever black people live on the earth. No black man is free nowhere until all of us enjoy it. I'm not finished. Bear with me a few more minutes. They had black leaders meeting with members of my staff, asking the members of my staff to come and tell me to cool it. And I'm glad the members of my staff were not stupid. Because if one of them had opened his mouth to ask me to cool it, he'd have been on ice today.
That right now, I'm telling you straight up. See, there was a time that Muhammad allowed people to do anything to him. And it looked as though Muhammad was really cowardly, when in reality, he loved the people so much, he never wanted to hurt what he loved. But I'll be damned if I'm gonna stand by and let any combination of Negro leaders jump up and attack me, and I'm not gonna say nothing. I'll declare war on your behind from this day forth. know, man, Muslims can bite too. You have to be. I mean, where else? I mean, we all might as well get together and march on together. Because this is the end of the whole thing. If we lose our lives, so what? Our people will be free. Then that's what we want. Freedom of the masses. That's right. God got us between a rock and a hard place. You ain't got no place to go and then no place to hide. It's straight ahead. We are brothers and sisters and family. I don't know everything. I know very little. What I know, but what I don't know, my brother got it. My sister got it. We just need to see ourselves as one family and don't be envious and jealous of each other, but recognize that God created us all and we all got a part to play in this thing. No, there ain't gonna be no spectators. You watch Dr. King, but you ain't gonna watch this. You watch Malcolm, but you're not gonna watch this. Because see, my mouth, God made it in such a way where it draws down fire on everybody. You're on your job, minding your business. And a Jew will ask you, what do you think about that guy Farrakhan? And don't you deny me. Don't you deny me. You stand up. One brother told me, he's a fine movie actor. He was in the office the other day, working for a part. And all of a sudden I came on the television. The Jew turned and said, that man there, he's the worst.
The brother didn't say nothing. He looked back at the brother. He said, do you know him? He said, yes, I know him. So what do you think about him? The Jew dropped his head. I mean, look. You gotta be able just to stand up. All you gotta do is try it once, and when you try it, you'll love it. Look. Look. When they would come and talk to us about the Panthers, that's what they want. Put the microphone in your face. What do you think about it? Come on, brother. And I'm supposed to say, I'm going to talk to you about it. I really don't think too much of it at all. Here you go with your lace underwear again. No, you stand up. They're my brothers and sisters. While I say not the truth, but every sister they say or do, that's my family. I ain't giving any news about my family. What should we say? You're all not Muslims. I mean, from belief, I'm talking about. You're Muslim by nature, but you're not that way by belief. And I might be dead a long time before you all really declare your allegiance to Allah. But that's all right. The important thing is that if you hear them talking about your Muslim brother, some of you know them. You're not a total stranger. Don't rob nobody, don't cheat nobody.
rambotted your wife or your daughter. I don't sell your daughter drugs. I don't drink. I'm consistent in what I'm about. You may not like what I'm about, but that's what I've been about. When the truth comes to you, say, if you didn't come here, what are you supposed to say? You're supposed to tell him, you better put the hell out of my house. And if you stood up, you'd find a Jew just retreating. You see him? What'd he do to Moab? What'd he do to Moab? That would do the moonwalk on earth. And then he'd go to the moon and try to do it there, brother. Black folk just got to stand up. So one of my friends called me from California.
I said, yeah, well, I'll be there.
Ain't no storm big enough to keep me out of my apartment. I just can hear the voice. You see the scripture being fulfilled. I got there in a way that my own security was befuddled. I threw the whole security staff off. They're going one way and I'm coming another. Because I know the enemy watches my son. You know that my son will kill country for his father. Oh, yeah. And I wish every father had a son like this. When your son loves the father and is willing to kill the enemies of his father. When he was 10 years old, he told me that he wanted to be an executor. He don't know nothing but kill the enemy of God. He's gone into the world to do that. I asked him one day, I said, son, I tested him. I said, suppose your father messed up. He said it would hurt me, but I have to kill you too. I said, the boy passed the test. As long as I'm on the straight path, the boy should be behind his father. When the father deviates, gone with God, and slain the deviant. There is no God but Allah. When you got children coming up like that, that's what the white man is afraid of. He's scared of people that have a philosophy. He's scared of people that have a religion where they can strap themselves with arms and have tea with you. And get to me knowing that they're going up, but you're going too. They don't want a religion that makes a man look at his body and know that it's a house for the spirit. And he's not afraid to give it up at any time or to take someone out when it's necessary. I'm not talking about no pumped up religion. Make little frail sisters out of you.
Somebody's stomping the hell out of you. Just, I gotta love him.
Talking about no praise and this like that. I'm talking about a religion that makes you tolerant to a certain point. When you reach that point, then they go to war and they don't stop until all is forgotten. That's why the wicked fear what they call in Arabic jihad. Holy war. When I was in Mecca, I saw a sight that touched me so. And when I talked about it, I cried because I know what a Muslim is. When a Muslim believes in Allah and is willing to sacrifice his everything for God, when that Muslim sees an enemy nation or people that is oppressive and focuses their attention on that people to slay them or to be slaves,
have lined up the whole state against us. So, aren't these people rather overdoing this? Every day on the news, man. Farrakhan is in Phoenix. Every day on the news. Farrakhan is coming.
I slipped in. When security knew anything, I was sitting in the suite. I already came a different room. Because we had the final hour now. Whoever is who is going to become manifest. Whatever you are, it's going to come on out. Allah bless you. When I look that Saturday, I couldn't see from my window, but 5 o'clock in the afternoon, there was the press out in front of the field. With a very home. We're expecting a Lewis Farrakhan in a few hours. Already, there are over 100 people at Farrakhan. I mean, who's those spots where I go before? An hour later, as we go again, I don't know where these people are coming from. My God, my God! Oh, they're lined up out there. We haven't seen the JDL yet, they're threatening to pick it up. Finally, when the JDL came, this is their chorus.
Farrakhan is a cunt. Farrakhan is a cunt.
Hey, look at this. 19,000 blacks, Chicanos, Indians, Puerto Ricans. Yeah. And every time they say, oh, God. Boy, it's getting softer and softer. I couldn't believe it. The scouts came back and said, there's 5,000 men out there, we can't count to 50. This was at 6 o'clock. The door's open. Program to begin at 7. Farrakhan to speak with 8. By the time I got there, I couldn't believe what I was looking for.
from the stage all the way up. All the way up. Everywhere you look. And they received me in such a way that if I didn't have my mind on my business, I'd just stop and cry, you know? The love that only God could put in the hearts of a people for a man that they hardly know about. You see, God is given to me what don't belong to me. See, it belongs to Marcus Garvey. It belongs to Noble Drew Ali. It belongs to Booker T. It belongs to Paul Robeson. It belongs to Malcolm. It belongs to the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. It belongs to Martin Luther King. But the black masses were not ready when these men appeared. The black masses were asleep. And I say this with deep humility. The masses were ready to give all of this to Reverend Jackson. The masses were ready to say, Reverend Jackson, here we are. But Reverend Jackson had his mind on black people, and he lost the black people. Let me tell you, brother, you got to say to hell with the white man. If you ain't got that kind of courage, go to hell. People don't want no handkerchief head nigger. They got one foot in the white man's house and another one in the black man's house. Talking a whole bunch of BS that you love all people. Stop that crap. How the hell you gonna love all people if all people include your enemy? You don't love black people, which is your own people. You're not qualified to love anybody else. It is because I love my own black people that God expand my breath for the Chicanos and for the American Indians and for other oppressed people. But the root is your love of yourself and your people. You want unity with everybody before you get it with your own black self. $19,000. And in the end of the speech, and I'm closing now, I look to them at the leaders that have come to sit with me, that their presence might be a moment. Or maybe even a reminder, hoping that I would turn my back and turn to them. And I say, you teachers, sing the song when you can, and they crucified my Lord. That's what you always do. Every generation, when God gives you one to speak to you. And King started speaking against the war in Vietnam. The black leader left King all alone. Malcolm was all alone from the beginning. Malcolm started making the case of black people an international issue. He was a dangerous man, too dangerous to live. And the squabble between us and Malcolm was used as camouflage. We did have a squabble. It was sad and sinful. Out of that tragedy, he lost a man that could have been a great help in the struggle in 1985. 60 years old, 61, just coming into his wisdom. There was sadness in the black community. There was joy. And some of the listeners, there was joy. Yes, but it's true. I was sad. Because a man that I knew and loved, he taught me, he was like a father to me. Had left my father and his father, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, for whatever the reasons were. And this split caused this tragic chapter in our history, which robbed us of that. All of that was for purpose. So today, the black folk come out, 19,000, 10,000 in another city, 8,000 in another city, 5,000 in another city. This younger generation is paying tribute to all the others that their parents have been. So we can't take any credit because we didn't lay the foundation. We're only standing on the foundation that was already laid for us by greater men that had gone on. I will not be untrue to that foundation. I am a Muslim. I don't want you to think I got some religion. There's an atheist of the masses. I don't want you to think religion has been used or it has been abused. But I do have something in my life that can absolutely ignite religion. And lend the religion that is in your soul. I'm not talking about what you've been taught your life. I'm talking about the religion of your nature. When that is ignited, when you recognize that you are nothing more than a continuum, you're a finite being who came and will leave, but in you is past, present, and future. And our silly brother Tom Bradley, he lost. He wants to be governed. So he's trying to keep the blacks. It's the dance that puts you in politics. We don't need but a few more days. But there's another side to fast time. You know, I know what he's about to do. today. I ordered all white police after they had attacked the mosque. The brothers hit them. One of their number died. I said, no white police. They took them out for that night. Honorable Elijah Muhammad said to me, he said, son, don't speak ahead of your power to do. He said, 15% of the people are with you. 35% are sympathetic. 50% are not with you at all. He said, you go home. You take that 15%. Then you work on the 35% that's sympathetic. And you have them on your side till they are like the 15%. Don't go over into the 50% that are against you. You get 25% of those with you. And you keep ordering. He told me out of his mouth, straight up. He said, one day I'll order you to kill me. Come up in a meeting. I would give you an order to kill a man. He said, and when I give that order, carry out. And don't worry about the police. I will handle them myself. I don't believe coming from a man of God.